I will be discussing about lock-in amplifier. It will we'll talk in length about everything and also a review of SR830. So why we need a lock-in amplifier? So it's pretty much question. This pretty much standard instrument, almost every lab in the world has it and you can't get rid of it. So let's assume you want to measure a signal of 10 nanovolt at 10 kilohertz. Okay, so this is the aim you're looking for. So the good amplifier noise is typically on the ballpark range to 5 nanovolt per root hertz, that's very good actually. If the bandwidth is 100 kilohertz, say the bandwidth is 100 kilohertz, we'll just measure across it. Gain is 1000. So we'll find out what is the signal and what is the noise. So signal is 10 nanovolt multiply by 1000 will be 10 microvolt. Okay, and the noise will be 5 nanovolt per root hertz. You have to take the square root because you have to take out this hertz part. So the way you will get 1.6 millivolt. So the signal is 10 microvolt and your noise is 1.6 millivolt. It's pretty bad, right? So how do you get rid of it? Now from here you can see you can get rid of it if your bandwidth is very 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 small. So that's what happened in lock-in amplifier. In lock-in amplifier, you use called PSD, which is phase density detection. The bandwidth can be as narrow as 0.01 hertz. So that's what I have done. I have plugged in these numbers and you get 0.5 microvolt. Voila, and everything is done. So the whole point of using lock-in amplifier, the bandwidth of that detection, that is you lock at particular frequency. That is the point. That's how we call lock-in, and it amplifies, of course, so it is amplifier. So because of the locking, which is here is 0.01 hertz, you get a narrow bandwidth, and because of that your noise is very 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 low. So I'll just be talking about the principles, how does a lock-in amplifier works, and this is going to be a pretty much easy, it's pretty much standard actually. So what I'm going to do is, let's say Your signal is A1 cos 2 pi fs plus theta s, and your reference is A2 cos 2 pi frt. So this is your signal goes here, and this is called PSD, phase strength. Basically it is a multiplier. So you take this guy, your reference, and you multiply it. Okay, so you multiply it and you pass through a low pass filter. I will come to that. Now you take this guy and you shift this one to 90 degree and you multiply again and you again pass through loop pass filter, so you'll get Y. So normally Y is 90 degree out of phase with X, so that's why X is called in phase, Y is called out of phase component. Now if you multiply it to cosine function, you'll get two frequencies, right? Very easily, FS plus FR and FS minus FL. Now using low pass filter, the point of using it to get rid of FS plus FR. And now low pass filter has that can be many kind of role of. Now for example, I'll draw a simple, in our lock-in amplifier you'll see, so this is amplitude, this is frequency, you'll have different role of order. So I'll just draw it. So this may be 6 dB and this is 24 dB roll off. So depending upon, so it will start cutting here somewhere. So now there will be a compromise here because 6 dB or amplitude will be okay, but it will go to higher frequency. But in 24 dB, your amplitude will be smaller. I mean to say it will start cutting off earlier. So it is quite difficult in that case, but yeah, it is always a trade-off. So the idea is pretty much clear. What you need to do is your signal is multiplied and it passed through low pass filter, and that's the way you get rid of it. And also what you also do is you also keep the phase same also, and in that way if you see, you'll have this component FS minus FL, so you'll get zero here, and also you can shift this theta s to zero. So in that way you get a DC component. So what you have done is actually demodulated the signal from some frequency and FS and FR to a DC component. Now if you draw in xy, because you are have r and theta quadrature, so r will be x square plus y square and theta will be tan inverse y over x. So I think it should be pretty much clear. That's how we get rid of it. Basically a low pass filter and does the job, and phase sensitive detection, which is multiplication. Now I'll come to this lock-in amplifier SR830. Why? Because I'm going to discuss about in detail. What are all buttons? You know, I have found out people, we always struggle with, there are so many, it has so many functions that can't imagine in one instrument. So basically you have here you have inputs, so A, B and I. So A, B, A for single ended, B for differential, and I is for current. Then it passes through a notch filter, which will remove the 50 hertz, 60 hertz and 120 hertz noise. As an amplifier again, there they put the monitor out. You can take, I'll show you what is this monitor out here. So you can also take this, it's in the back of the lock-in amplifier. So this is one part. You go there and now you need from other part a reference in, because this is your signal is coming in, signal has come, you have filtered it out, you have amplified it. So reference comes, it is phase locked to internal oscillator, so which is pretty much important part, and then it is multiplied with this guy, okay, to get. So this is x, then it is, you see, it is passed through low pass filter, that's how you get x. Now to get y, what you need to do, you need to multiply this guy with 90 degree, right? Very clearly. So it has come, so you take a from here, it has gone, signal has gone to 90 degree phase shifter, and it multiplied by this guy. Okay, so again you pass through a low pass filter, and that's how you get it. Great. So you get a Y. Now to get R and Phi, from here, you know, the software does automatically X square plus Y square and tan inverse Y by X to get it done. And from here, he has shown us you can take it sine output and TTL out from here. So basically it is a multiplication through a low pass filter, and for X and for Y, you just phase shift by 90 degree and you just multiply again through low pass filter. So which does the job here. So here this guy phase locked looped is very important, because the reference, what it does, the internal oscillator get locked to the reference, and that's how you get a DC component, because that will make omega R reference and omega signal to zero, which will make it DC. And plus also the phase has to be always similar between them, otherwise you will get again a component out of it, the phase. So so this guy takes care of it also, so the phase is also similar. Now let's talk about this lock-in amplifier SR830. So what I have here is, we'll zoom in, I think, yeah. So first, this part is called reference. So what I have done, I have taken a BNC from sine out and connected to the A part of the lock-in amplifier. So now, what is this? Is the reference part. So you can select what frequency. Amplitude, harmonics, it is very important. For example, thermal conductivity, you can go to third harmonic or something like that. Amplitude, I have gone 4 millivolt, because you know you can't put at output more than 1 volt, which is dangerous. Frequency, you can go from 1 millihertz to 102 kilohertz, as I remember. You can have a phase, you can shift the phase, that is what phase shift is there. Now internal means you are using, because this has a frequency synthesizer also, so the reference is from internally. That's how you get the sign out. Now if you want, for example, you have a more precise synthesizer than this guy, what you can do, you can put in reference in, that's why this button is there, and you can detect it. Now let's come to the input part. This was the reference part. Let's come to the output part, signal output, input, sorry. So this is a single ended, double ended, differential, sorry, A minus B and I. So you can measure the current also if you are doing two probe measurement. Now if you see, there are two type of coupling, AC and DC. AC, you only apply AC to pass the DC, means direct coupling, not DC only, which is confusing. So it will allow everything to pass through. So this is float and ground. So you can either use floating, means it will connect some, I don't know, some how much resistance to the before the grounding. So it will be floating, basically it will not be grounded to the chassis. Ground means it's chassis. What else here? So we have on the top of it is time constant. Okay, so you can have a time constant is the time constant of the low pass filter. So it varies, it has a quite lot of range. So there is a again a trade off here. If you want data taking very fast, you need to take the lower time constant. But if you are taking the, if you want a good data, you know, good averaging, you need to higher time constant, but it will take a lot of time. So there is a compromise here. So that's what the filtering I'm talking about, roll of 6, 12, 18, 24. So I select 24 dB because amplitude is okay for me. And you can shift from here, whatever you want. Sensitivity, you know, depending upon signal, what signal you have, you need to move on the different various sensitivity. Now one thing you have noticed, I given 4 millivolt, but I'm getting 3.044, probably because my input amplifier, this input is not very good, A has been destroyed now, so I fix it, but it's not very good. Now what else we have here, we have reserve. So there is a high, normal and low noise. So reserve means how much your amplifier can, you know, detect us. This is, for example, op instrument can detect a signal out of a, you know, huge background of noise. For example, 1 dB, 120 dB of noise. Dynamic reserve means you can detect 1 microvolt of signal when the background is 1 volt. That is quite amazing. So this guy has a dynamic reserve of more than 100 dB, which is pretty good. So what else we have is this filters, which you see, line filter, and so filters is line and 2 into line, which means it is notch filter actually. It's very good because the line filter is the main culprit I have found. So we'll have a 50 hertz and 100 hertz removed, and 60 hertz also they made it. It starts from 30, I have seen it start from 20 hertz and goes around 400 hertz. It's okay. So now you are seeing in the front panel channel 1 and channel 2, so which is 2 for X and Y. This is channel 1 is X and Y. So you have, you can measure here X, R, X noise, aux in 1, and that we'll talk about aux in 1, aux in 2. We'll talk about that. Now X, you know what it is, R, you know, underscore X plus Y square. So X noise, it use MAD, moving average deviation method, to calculate X noise. So you can measure noise also with this instrument. Aux in 1, aux in 2, we'll talk about it. Now let's, this is the display. So now what else you can also do with, for example, you want to measure the changes in the signal. So you press auto offset, you make it, it will make it zero, it will, you know, do the digital. And you can also amplify the signal 10 times and 100 times. So while doing a 1 hour of noise measurement, normally that's what many people does, including me also sometimes. So same with the Y channel, we do the same thing. Now what else here, we have a auto function. So you want to do, because you need to get rid of the phase also, so this will mix. If you press this button, it will make the phase in Y 0. Earlier it will be something else. Now gain, it will choose automatically sensitivity you want to have, because the gain here is 10 divided by sensitivity. So also reserve, it will select automatically depending on the conditions and everything. What else is left? I think this part is done. Now I'll go on the back side of this instrument very carefully. It's very important because this guy has a voltmeter, this guy has a oscilloscope. It's pretty amazing what they have made in one instrument. So here we are. Now what you are seeing here is TTL out. So it is from the TTL out, basically it depends on the frequency. So I think it will work. It's a square wave, you know that. Transistor to transistor logic with different, you can have a different amplitude and frequencies. TTL out, XY is the same. You can again borrow the, it's like borrow, it's same part of the another BNC, with the same as front part. Aux out is a 16 bit, aux out is a, it's like a voltmeter, minus 10 to, minus 10.5 to plus 10.5 volt. So it's a 16 bit DAC, which is pretty amazing. So you have a 4, so basically you can do pretty much everything. Monitor out, I already told you input, where is you can find it, just after the amplification. So it is just after the amplification. So this is, you can also be before doing any kind of filtering and multiplication, which is pretty amazing. Aux in is it's like oscilloscope, so it's a 16 bit again, 16 bit and digital to analog DAC, so which is pretty amazing. It's good oscilloscope, I will say, to say it to start with, okay, but not amazing. Sorry about that, but 16 bit is really in microvolts you can go. So preamp, you have a preamp here, so they have given the, we generally, you know, all the preamp require a DC power supply, so it is pretty boring, or it's cumbersome to have a different power supply, like, you know, you bring a battery and do it. So this guy made it by themselves, but they make their own preamplifiers, SR560, if I remember, BJT, transformer amplifier, that's all they, I think it's pretty much. You have two kinds of interfacing of this instrument, RS232 and GPIB IEEE. And what else is, there is a fuse here and on off switch and fan but okay, that's all. I think it's pretty good. You can measure noise, you can almost can do anything with this pretty good instrument in one case, and that's all. Thank you.